You have worked with the Health Resources and Services Administration, but we're in the Parkland Building, and it was once characterized to me as the world's largest filing cabinet, and so it's great to be in a lovely venue like this. I'm also really pleased to have the opportunity to meet with a group of folks who began their day yesterday, or toward the end of the day yesterday, had presentations on the future of Medicare and Medicaid in light of the Super Committee's default reduction process, and then segued into the sequestration process. You know, you must be an interesting group of folks with a lot of very interesting issues. You had the good sense to move to a cocktail hour after that, so. It was very heavy lifting, I am sure. Oh, I'm sorry. Sir, that is not what we're talking about here. I'm very pleased to be here, however, truly to represent the Health Resources and Services Administration and talk about HRSA's role in developing the nature's future health professions workforce. And I believe that in many ways, HRSA and PQC, sure. I believe that in many ways, HRSA and PQC have a very shared agenda and a shared vision for the nation's health workforce. I had the opportunity to review your paper, The Partnership for Quality's Transforming Healthcare, America's Healthcare Workforce. And the issues that you raised in your paper are very similar to those that my agency seeks to address through our grant programs and through our policy work. And the goals are really very similar to HRSA's workforce interests. Developing a workforce ready to deliver coordinated, comprehensive, high-quality care, exploring the lessons learned about the delivery of care and design of education and training programs that produce providers for new models of care, coordinating our workforce investments across federal, state, and local efforts, creating a workforce that has increased diversity, flexibility, and skills, and practicing team-based, coordinated, continuous care for patients. That's exactly what HRSA is interested in doing through its workforce programs, and so we truly do have a shared agenda. In addition, HRSA, like PQC, is concerned about the expansion of coverage to 32 million more Americans as a result of the ACA. And this expansion, when you couple it with an aging population and increased chronic disease burden, will certainly create increased demands for care that we need to be prepared to address. So we share those goals, those interests, those concerns, and we also share your concern about the cost of care and the need to integrate prevention and primary care. The need for quantifiable performance measures. These are all issues that you raised in your paper in all areas where we have work underway. Another concern we share with you regarding the adequacy of the workforce is our own health workforce, because we indeed are employers. HRSA employs healthcare providers, doctors and nurses, a few random dental hygienists, and certainly we have a great and important relationship with the health centers. And while we don't own the health centers, we certainly help to invest in them through your tax dollars, and they employ over 131,000 staff. That includes 9,500 physicians, 3,900 nurse practitioners, 3,000 dentists, more than 4,000 mental health providers, and 13,000 folks who are the management and support staff. So we are very concerned that there's a robust, well-trained workforce that's prepared to care for the 20 million people that HRSA supports through its health center activities. So I think, I'm pretty sure that my task here as the Fed du jour is to explain what we are doing in HRSA around workforce, to talk a little bit about some of our current activities and partnerships, to listen to your suggestions, and then to consider practical and appropriate opportunities for collaboration around our shared vision for the nation's workforce. I want to also introduce to you Dr. Jan Heinrich. Dr. Heinrich is the Associate Administrator at HRSA who directs our Bureau of Health Professions. And so she is the person who is the frontline individual for managing a significant part of HRSA's workforce portfolio. And this is, if you are a speaker, this is an ideal situation because I get to give the comments, listen to a few of your questions, preferably the easy ones, and then Jan can stay with you for a longer period of time because you're running a little late, and I am not clear how this happened, but I'm doing four sets of remarks today, this being the first one. So Jan can stay with you a little longer, so if you have more questions than we're able to get to, she'll be able to talk with you. I'm curious, how many of you know the Health Resources and Services Administration and know much about it? How many of you could give this speech? You've spent so much time doing HRSA watching. This guy says I could do this speech. Anytime you'd like to step up, you're welcome to. So my agency, HRSA, is the primary federal agency charged with improving access to health services, particularly for those populations that are underserved and experience the greatest disparities in accessing care. We have a budget of about $9.7 billion, and we manage over 80 different programs. And for those of you who know HRSA pretty well, then you're probably familiar with our Community Health Center program, the Maternal and Child Health Services Block Grant, and the Ryan White program that provides care for folks living with HIV and AIDS. You may know a little less about some of our other programs. We manage the discounted drug program, the 340B program. We provide care for people with Hansen's disease, which is the medical term for leprosy. And as a result, we have an armadillo research farm. I bet even the HRSA watchers did not know that. That's the animal on which you can do most effective research for Hansen's disease. So we grow our own. And then we also support organ donation. So it's a really broad range of programs. And many of our programs, you know, are either directly and legislatively created, you know, you would call them budget lines, to provide health professions training. But throughout our entire agency, we try to support workforce development. So it's been great that the Recovery Act and the ACA brought new resources to our workforce investments, but we really try to magnify those and leverage through the rest of the agency so that they are engaged in workforce development too. So I'm going to speak about the programs that directly support workforce and that are part of our shared vision, those principally being Title VII and Title VIII programs and the National Health Service Corps and the Loan Scholarship Repayment Programs. But I also want to talk with you about other HRSA activities, and then we'll get into the ones that are specifically targeted to workforce. Here's the idea. We have a significant investment in workforce. And because of the Recovery Act and because of the ACA, that investment in workforce has significantly increased. But at the end of the day, if you can make a $7.9 billion agency, think about workforce sort of holistically. And if you can leverage our other federal partners, we're much more likely to have the opportunity to move workforce development in the direction that we want to go. So some of the other things that we do in HRSA is work through our Office of Rural Health Policy. I used to direct the Federal Office of Rural Health Policy, hence living in West Virginia. One of the things that was troublesome was that rural constituents would come in to speak with me, and they would say to me, you know, they'd sort of fold their arms across their chests, and they'd say, pointy-headed bureaucrat, what could you possibly understand about the concerns of rural and frontier communities? And it was very helpful to have a bit of rural cred to say, well, you know, I live in West Virginia, I started my day there, I'll end my day there, and I have septic dial-up, and I'm well, and there's an outhouse on my property, you know? And they thought, you might understand some of what we're gonna talk with you about. And so within HRSA, the department's Office of Rural Health Policy resides there, and it's one of those organizational decisions that was made some time ago, but there's a lot of like programming there. And ORHP, like those of you who serve rural communities, faces some of its greatest challenges around workforce. And how can you ensure that there's an adequate number of well-trained healthcare providers serving rural communities? And so there are a couple of activities that that they're doing that are examples of not necessarily legislatively mandated programs, but also programs that HRSA is engaged in to serve rural communities. And one of them that I would highlight is a project called the Rural Recruitment and Retention Network, or 3RNet. And it's basically an interactive service between rural providers who are seeking to hire healthcare professionals and individuals who are interested in moving to rural communities. And so if you are a physician in Manhattan, New York, and you've enjoyed all of New York that you can enjoy, and you think you'd like to try a different lifestyle, you might want to see what's happening in Manhattan, Kansas, you know, and there might be a provider looking to hire you. So it's sort of a dating service for those who have jobs and those who are seeking them. The other thing that they've been doing is developing a set of tools for community health workers and in particular trying to develop an evidence base for the impact that community health workers have on quality and access to care. And I know that you all have been looking at different kinds of provider types, and this is a tool that you might find useful. Another thing that you might recall is that, as I said, the Health Center program employs over 130 healthcare providers, and certainly they are very much concerned and have an adequately trained and well-distributed workforce. And so we have a partnership with the National Association of Community Health Centers to support a clinical recruitment activity so that if you're a health center and you have a vacancy, folks can go to that website and find out where you might get a job in health centers serving underserved communities. We're also trying to do whatever we possibly can to partner with states, and so I'm going to highlight two important activities. You know, frankly, at the end of the day, the states may be our most important partners because it is the states that provide the resources for training, whether that's community colleges, at universities or academic health centers, in large part. So our Bureau of Primary Health Care has been working with ASTO, Association of State and Territorial Health Officers, to do some workforce planning. And likewise, and perhaps Janet can spend more time talking about this later, because of the ACA, we had a number of opportunities to partner with states through workforce development grants. And so I think we have 24 that are up and running that are developing state workforce plans. And so these are a couple of examples of how we're working across the agency on activities that aren't necessarily legislatively mandated. But let's move to those. We have a really significant portfolio of workforce programs. And if you look at what we do, they parallel very similarly the kinds of things that you outline in your paper. We provide pipeline programs for developing young people's interests in going into health careers and health professions. One of the things I'm really interested in finding out more about is how effective those programs are. You know, if a nurse goes and visits a fifth grade health class, what does that mean 7 years later when someone's making a career decision? And so, it would be really interesting for me to know what the evidence supports in how we deploy these pipeline programs. We support students and residents in their training. We have ongoing investments in continuing education. A lot of that activity takes place through the AHEC program. And we also support the infrastructure to ensure a quality health professions training, and that would include things like faculty development, innovations and training curricula, and the development of community-based clinical training sites. And so the Recovery Act and the ACA invested millions of dollars into health professions training, and some of those investments were made most recently through resources that came to us through the Prevention and Public Health Fund, with a recognition that you improve prevention and primary care through investing in primary care providers. And so there was $455 million that went into the creation of a more robust primary care workforce. You guys know the literature better than anyone. At the end of the day, investments in primary care significantly decrease cost and improve outcomes. And so we invested in training nearly 900 new primary care physicians. We invested in schools of nursing to increase the number of nurse practitioners. We invested in PA programs to increase the number of physician's assistants. And we invested in a new activity, which was the Teaching Health Center program, which encourages community health centers and similar kinds of providers to become training sites for residents in hopes that at the end of the day that those are the practice settings that they'll choose to play out their career in, serving the folks that we see in those health centers. And so those are some of the most obvious investments that came to us most recently. The other thing that we've invested in significantly, and that's new, I think, for the agency, is our National Center for Health Workforce Analysis. Going on 3 years ago, it was my privilege to engage in the process of developing the health reform law. And so we would go to the White House and meet with the folks who were on the health reform team. And they were asking about HRSA programs, HRSA's investments. This president clearly understands the importance of an adequately trained, well-distributed health workforce. And they would, the folks who were on the team in the White House would ask us specific questions about the numbers of physicians, the need for certain types of physicians, the adequacy of the nurse practitioner workforce, the adequacy of the PA workforce, and then questions about other kinds of providers, allied health, et cetera, to ensure that we had the complement of providers that we needed to from our perspective, deliver primary care. We couldn't answer those questions very effectively because there's just not good data. There aren't good data about our workforce. And so this national center is something that we're very hopeful can begin to inform policymaking decisions about what the future of the workforce should be and what is the adequacy if we're thinking in terms of numbers. Another area that we've been actively engaged in and that's also central to your discussion in your paper is interprofessional education. It's clear that we need to change the way that we deliver healthcare. You know, I remember being with my mom and things were not going so well and she was in the hospital. And you know, every individual who came in is someone that you wanted to trust and feel confident in. And by and large, these were folks that you know, were well-trained and were very supportive of the family. It's really helpful to have six sisters and a brother in this situation, you know, because there's always somebody who can be there to hear what the conversations were. The thing that I worried about was whether or not they were talking to each other when they were on the other side of the wall. And so interprofessional education is something that HRSA thinks as an agency is an area that we can lead in. And so we've been very actively engaged in a partnership with the Macy Foundation, Robert Wood Johnson and the American Board of Internal Medicine, their foundation, and the Interprofessional Education Collaborative to examine what the core competencies are, what the skills are, what do folks need to know to practice interprofessional care effectively? Because we all know the way we are trained to be healthcare providers is sort of silo by silo. As a matter of fact, I recall in my own experience, even when you went to the cafeteria as a student, you sat with a cohort of folks that were in your discipline. You know, and so how do we ensure that both in the classroom and in the clinical setting, we help folks have the skills that they're going to need to be effective? And so we've been actively engaged in this work, and if there's opportunity, then Jan might be able to talk a little bit more about that. Another area that I think is very exciting for us, and certainly is not the solution to our workforce challenges and shortages, but is one very important step in the right direction, has been the President's support and the Congress's support for the expansion of the National Health Service Corps. Many of those folks, about half of them, serve in health centers, and if we've expanded the health center program significantly, and we have, you know, how do we increase the number of folks who are there to provide primary care? And so the National Health Service Corps, which is a way of providing loan repayment in exchange for serving in those areas that are hardest to serve, has doubled and will double again. And at the end of this federal fiscal year, we'll go to about 8,000 physicians, nurse practitioners, PAs, dentists, mental health care providers. The remarkable thing about that program, and the thing I think that's least known, is that a substantial number of those folks stay in those settings. You know, and it becomes a career choice to do the very rewarding work of serving those folks who are most difficult to serve. And so we've got another $1.5 billion to expand the National Service Corps through 2015. And we are trying to make the best of that opportunity. For those of you who have had an opportunity to work with the National Service Corps, I hope that you have noticed that it's not your grandfather, it's not your father's National Health Service Corps. We've worked really hard to streamline the application process, and we've built a number of ways to connect the core folks. If you are the physician from Manhattan who moves to Manhattan, you know, Manhattan, Kansas may seem really different from your environment. What is it like to practice in a small town? You know, and so if you can build a community around these National Health Service Corps providers, will do even better in keeping them in these underserved areas. So we built a Facebook page for them, and for you to know that for the federal government to move into social media is a very novel thing. Our folks in IT, rightly so, are really worried about the firewalls, you know, and they should be. But we need to have sort of on-demand, instantaneous communication with those folks that we're supporting in these most underserved communities, whether they're rural or urban. Our director of communications came into me one day, very sort of smug, and said, "You know, our Facebook page, the activity is up about 3,000%. I go, "Well, Marty, we didn't have a Facebook page before. You know, of course it's up 3,000%. But it is an example of how we're going to need to provide sort of on-demand support for clinicians who are used to living in an on-demand support world. You know, I need this information now. And so that's something that we've been beginning to model. So I'll close by saying, I think that the things that you've suggested are dead on in your paper. I was really also interested in the notion of developing new provider types. I know it's a bit heretical, but every once in a while I think, could you almost sort of zero-base the health professions and repackage the skill mix for the setting that folks are going to need to be practicing in? You know, and what would those folks look like? You know, would you create a extra nutritionist, you know, who helps to shape me up and slim me down, as opposed to having an exercise physiologist and a nutritionist or a dietitian? I mean, is there somebody that you could combine, some way to combine those skills? So I'll close here and hopefully have time to answer, yes, a few of your questions. But just want to say that, you know, we support what you're doing. We think that your recommendations and your focus are dead on. It would be terrific if I could say, and these are the answers to your questions about the future. This we have to figure out together. But the one thing I think that's true is that we have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to look at how we deliver healthcare. I mean, unless you were around for the creation of Medicare and looking around, I don't think any of you were. I don't think there's ever been an opportunity to reframe delivery of healthcare in this nation similar to the one that we have today. And so we would like to partner with you in that. You're a very important player in this activity. And thank you very much for the chance to visit with you this morning.
Thank you. Thank you, Doc. Can I put the mic on? Thank you, Dr. Brand. And we're moving forward to the next phase. And I'd like to introduce now from Manhattan, New York, Dr. Bill Epstein, who is the University Dean for Health and Human Services for the City University of New York and the founding director of the John F. Kennedy Institute for Worker Education. And he will moderate this part of the panel. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Dennis. And thank you, Dr. Brand. Really, it's so important that you were able to join us today because we know we have yesterday we talked about redeploying the workforce, a new workforce, transition workforce, a future workforce, and we know how important that HRSA has to be for that for us going forward. So it's really great that you could be here. So I'm just going to launch right into it. So I know that you may have to go. So I'll start off with the first question, sure. and then maybe open it up to everybody else. And the first question might be, Dr. Heinrich, yeah, I'm really glad that you could join us as well. So I know some of the questions relate probably very closely to the bureau that you direct. And so the first question is really maybe a question that's been talked about a lot, but I want to bring it up again since you're here, and we talked about the adequacy of the workforce, and we've talked about the nursing shortage. Nursing is very, we haven't talked that much about nursing in the first day, but it's really important for many reasons for the healthcare. And so we've had a nursing shortage. I represent the City University of New York. We have 23 colleges and professional schools. 13 of our schools offer nursing programs from 4 LPNs to 9 associate level. It's vast. About 1,500 nurse graduates every year. And we've really geared up to deal with the nursing shortage. But now, our new nurses are at the associate level and the baccalaureate are having trouble getting their jobs. And so it's a little bit of, I'm taking this opportunity from a university perspective, is you have a system that's, we have over 150 degree programs in the health professions. We can't just, turn them on and off. So I guess I wanted to get the latest update, the latest thinking from you about what's going on with the nursing. I mean, there's the nursing shortage, and yet we are having trouble getting our new nurses jobs. And we've had closings where nurses have lost their jobs, at least in New York City. So I just wanted to ask you your latest on that.
Fortunately for me, Dr. Heinrich is a nurse and directs our division of nursing and can very ably answer this question.
We hear that there are problems for new graduates of the nursing programs in certain areas. It's certainly not uniform across the country. There is growing demand for nurses as primary care providers, nurse practitioners especially. We also know that there's going to be a growing demand for nursing assistants, frontline workers, home health aides. We also are trying very hard to make sure that there are career trajectories in terms of being able to help people into the pipeline and then move along a career advancement. The other thing we have to remember is that we're dealing with a demographic imperative here. Whether we like it or not, those of us that are in the healthcare field are aging. I guess it beats the alternative, which means that in 4 to 5 years, you're going to see this huge drop-off of active, employed nurses because they're going to be retiring. That is also true for our physician workforce. So we really do have to think creatively with you in education about what we're going to do, how are we going to prepare for the 2015 period of time when we know that there's going to be a huge demographic change.
Thank you. So with that, let me open it up for questions from the audience. Debbie?
Also the chair of the New York State's committee under the HRSA grant to look at what we can do to prepare the healthcare workforce, which we've now been told also the second phase will not be funded. So considering this, I think it's so important nationally that we do planning about how to develop this new workforce. Is there anything that HRSA could do? For example, there are 24 states. I think that our state has developed a very good plan. But we would really like to know what the other states are developing. Could HRSA do a conference? Or are there any ways that we could move these issues in terms of national and state planning forward with these lack of resources? I think there are probably something that could be done in communication, I think would be something that would be very helpful.
Like you, we watch with interest the National Commission and understand that it has not been an appropriation, and we cannot begin that work until there is. And so we've heard from a number of folks a fair amount of frustration about the potential for this activity, and yet it hasn't been able to start up. There are a couple of things that are ongoing and underway that are helpful, and I think Jane has a few ideas too. One of them is the fact that we do, within the Bureau of Health Professions alone, have 4 national advisory committees, and one on nursing, one on interdisciplinary care, COGME, Council on Graduate Medical Education, and one on community-based activities and interprofessional activities. And while they are specifically looking at the portfolio programs that they provide comment on, the Bureau of Health Professions brings them together annually as a sort of a super advisory committee to talk broadly across the programs, and so that is one venue for that kind of discussion. Another activity that the Bureau has undertaken is the creation of the HWIC, the Health Workforce Information Center, which we are hoping to continue to grow. It's sort of one-stop shopping for some of the best practices. So, and it's particularly challenging in the health professions where nursing may be going down one path and physicians going down another path, and you could go discipline by discipline by discipline to see what the opportunities and challenges are. If we can get them all on one shared website, with some of the best thinking, some of the seminal pieces of literature, that might facilitate some of those discussions in the states. And Jan?
Yes. We wish that we could do more to help the Workforce Commission stand up, but we really have discussed different options, and we have none, I'm sorry to say. On the state workforce planning grants, we would really love to be able to move those programs to the next phase. Some programs have no cost extensions, and so they're continuing to leverage the fact that they are recognized entities. They've already been successful at pulling the players together to begin the plan for their state, and I think some are finding other resources other than the federal dollar to support their effort. Having said that, you bring up a very interesting point. Could we pull the grantees together? We did it once, face-to-face. We could certainly do something like a webinar where we could have a discussion online about different practices, where different grantees are in terms of the planning. What creative activities are people engaged in that could be shared? And we'll certainly, I'll take that back and we'll think about that.
I think we have time for one more question. Sorry? Yeah.
Yeah. Dr. Brand, we, as I said before, we represent close to 2 million healthcare workers and between the employers and us across the United States. They are literally, I know, close to privately funded more than $100 million, and I would venture there's a lot more, among all of our employers and our institution. I believe that it will be wise, or at least we're seeking, to have a more formal relationship with HRSA. So we could explore many of the initiatives that we put in our paper with you, and you could, if you could not provide funding, at least provide guidance and knowledge and share that as we try to build the new workforce of the future. So we would like to move into having a more formal conversation with you in which we could share ideas and see how we could come up with a PQC national training and educational and not only from the policy point of view, but in addition to that, on the ground, because right now, many of the people who are sitting in this room today are in charge of programs that are training thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of healthcare workers, and I think that it would be a good thing for all of us if we have a stronger relationship.
One other frustration that I've confronted in my work in this field is the scope of practice and how it differs from state to state, and to the extent that you guys could put pressure on different states by highlighting some of the more progressive things that are happening at all different levels in the workforce, that would be great pressure from my perspective.
So let me tee up a quick response, and then I'd ask Jan to amplify. One of the things that I said in my opening remarks was that I wanted to listen. And I hear very clearly your interest in continuing to collaborate in partnership with HRSA. The nature of that partnership, whether that's a shared activity or participation in your conferences, we need to work that out. But as I said also, we have lots of goals, very similar goals, and many of the recommendations that you've made around innovations are similar to things that we would want to engage in as well. So certainly let's see how we might, what the path forward might be. And in terms of scope of practice, this is something that, in particular, this secretary is very interested in scope of practice and has brought it to Secretary Sebelius, who is our the HHS secretary, has brought up in a number of venues and is interested in looking at scope of practice. And so We have a couple of ideas that we have sort of teed up and that we've been thinking about. It is not mine to announce what they might potentially be. That's career-ending. That's something that someone else might perhaps want to do. But we very clearly understand the challenges. And frankly, my original discipline, I'm a dental hygienist, and scope of practice has been the issue for those practitioners for a very long time. But we've been also very concerned about ensuring that folks work up to the highest level of their training, because that's how we're going to be able to deliver the highest quality care to the greatest number of people. So shared interest, we see some opportunities going forward, and it'll to some extent depend on resources, but it's something that we want to engage in.
And as a dentist, I could say,
oh, no.
They can do far more than they're allowed to do right now.
We're in Geneva, right.
Okay, well, I think our, do we have, is that time for us? Do we have time for another question? Yeah, one more question here, I guess, at least.
There's three or four.
Oh, three or four, okay.
I'll sit here for one and then you get the rest.
Yeah, okay.
Good morning. My name is Jack Cochran. I'm with Kaiser Permanente. I lead the National Physician Organization, which is the Permanente side of the organization. And I'm really very encouraged by the fact that we're talking about interprofessional collaboration and how that might be formalized. I think most of us train in our laudable silos.
Sure.
And as we moved into the information age of healthcare, we need a lot better team-based care, team-based capabilities, and people being able to work together. So I like the idea that you're teeing up the core competencies, and I think as an organization, Kaiser Permanente, as a PQC, we can start to put legs on that, because I think that's going to be one of the keys to delivering the right, you know, the right level of care to enough people, and to get the physician out of the notion that we have to know it all, because unfortunately the secret's out, we don't. So how do we go from where you're talking about developing competencies to really putting legs on this kind of training?
Okay. The cooperative that Marcia spoke of has really been extraordinary in that they've continued to work together. They've divided into subgroups and are developing proposals. And those proposals then are being looked at by private foundations, but also by the CMS Innovation Center, and certainly will be looked at by us as well, so that we can continue to move these ideas along, test them out. I think one of the more innovative ideas actually comes from Marilyn Chow of Kaiser, where they're talking about developing the practice sites where you have team-based practice, and overlaying that with teams of students who will train together. So instead of having the silos that you spoke of in the training, you're going to have teams of providers learning together in the clinical site.
So I want to just add a comment from my point of view. I think the work that's being done with interprofessional education is fantastic with physicians and nurses, and I know you've expanded it to some of the other health professions.
Pharmacists.
This is also a great team-based care issue for labor management, because the team isn't just the professionals. It would be nursing assistants and right. medical assistants and many other frontline workers right. who are really part of the team. So I'd love to see that approach expanded beyond the professional ranks to really get into true team-based care on the ground. And that really cuts into, it shows the importance of a labor management collaboration in going forward with that.
We absolutely must, or we're not going to have enough people to provide the care that we need to.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about the IOM report on the future of nursing and how
the agency
is thinking about that, because there are some very important recommendations that have come through that, including trying to get to baccalaureate degrees for 80% of nurses. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like a little bit of an unfunded mandate. And also, if you could speak about any work you're doing. doing around transition to practice for new grads, because that's another difficult area for hospitals to absorb new grads who need a lot of orientation.
Yes. I don't know if those of you in the back could hear the question, but it's about what are we doing to assist in implementing the IOM report on the future of nursing, and then what programs do we have to assist in the transition of new graduates? I assume you were thinking of nursing, but it's not only nursing, but nursing to practice. On the first issue, what are we doing to work with the implementation of the IOM report? We're doing a number of things. In terms of education, we do have programs that assist people to move along, as I said before, a career trajectory. So you could be an assistant, you could be an LPN, you could be an AA, RN, and there are programs that we fund that help people move forward in their career to a bachelor's, to a, hopefully an advanced degree. One of their recommendations also was to expand the number of nurses with doctorates, and we now in our programs no longer have a lid on the number of loan scholarships that we can provide to people seeking a doctorate. That really is to address the faculty shortage issue. Another one of their strong recommendations was that the states do something more about scope of practice, the question that was brought up before. And we are considering a number of different activities that could encourage states to study their scope of practice regulations and to see what innovative strategies they could use to change those so that people can practice to the highest level of their ability, to just name a few.
Great. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.